Hello everyone. Good morning, good afternoon everyone. Thank you all for joining us today for the presentation. So today we are going to present on building low carbon and climate resilient communities. So ACLS partnership is supporting Sri Lanka and Bhutan with climate resilient city action planning. We are here to share our learnings and outcomes experiences with you today. So this webinar and this exercise is supported by SDC, Swiss Agency for Development Cooperation, and Let's Global Partnership. Myself, Anandan, from Asia Leads Partnership. So we are based out of New Delhi. So ALP is hosted by ICLEI South Asia along with Southeast Asia and East Asia Secretariats of ICLEI. Next slide, please. So before we go on, a quick look at the agenda. So we will have an introduction about ALP, and then we will move on to the presentation on outcomes and key learnings from Kurnegala City, Sri Lanka, and Serpang District, Bhutan. My colleague Keshav from ACLS Partnership will present on it. And then we will have people from Bhutan and Sri Lanka sharing their experiences as part of this processes. And finally, we will have Q&A session. And before we move on, quick housekeeping rules for today. So most of the time, the participants will be in mute mode. We will unmute you during question and answer session. This is to avoid noises and echoes. At any point of time, we encourage you to type in your questions. You can see the options in the GoToWebinar. You can please send your questions. Under handouts option at the bottom, today's presentation can be downloaded. You can also use the chat option to let us know if you have any difficulties or anything you have to say. And next slide. Okay. About ACLS Partnership, many of you may know about ACLS Partnership, but there may be new people. So we would like to give a quick introduction about ACLS Partnership. It's a voluntary regional network that promotes low emission development strategies in Asia. It is one of the four regional platforms of Let's Global Partnership launched in 2011. So the other three regional platforms are Africa, Latin America, Caribbean, and the third one is Europe and Eurasia platform. So Let's GB is hosted by GIZ within the Support Paris Agreement project funded by BMU. Next slide. Next slide, please. Okay. So ACLS Partnership is supported by global working groups. So ACLS Partnership primarily helps in coordination and facilitation between countries. So the technical work is supported by the working groups such as these: governance, finance, sectoral working groups like AFOLO, energy and transport, and transparency. So the geographical coverage of ACLS Partnership is whole of Asia, Central and Pacific, including Australia and New Zealand. Next slide. The objectives of ACLS Partnership: we promote low emission development strategies in Asia through our services, through coordination, collaboration, and partnerships. ALP identify and share tools, resources, materials, success stories to enable peer learning. We also foster capacity building through our services, including we launch communities of practices on priority topics. We'll see about it in the coming slides. We do capacity building activities such as organizing webinars, in-person workshops based on priority areas of ALP members' need. We also develop knowledge products. There are technical assistances available for developing countries. We also do organized networking events. Next slide. So this is about ALP membership. We have 1,100 plus members. It comprises of individuals and organizations. 45 government organizations from 14 Asian countries are part of this larger network, and it's still growing. So when someone becomes members, they have access to training, technical assistance, capacity building, and other in-person and online resources on key Let's topics. So they also get opportunity for peer exchange, knowledge sharing, and collaboration. Membership is free, so we encourage you to take membership. We will share the slides to you later, so you can follow the link to join membership. Next slide. So coming to the ALP communities of practice, based on members' need, HLS partnership launched 4 communities of practice on the thematic areas such as energy, transport, subnational integration, and finance back in 2018, and we are still continuing. And we have planned activities under each of the communities of practice until December 2020. So what is a COP? So the thematic COP is an interactive platform. It helps, it brings practitioners, experts, national, subnational government people in one platform. It provides opportunity to share, learn from each other. COPs are member driven. So based on members' need, we select topics, say webinars such as these. We also organize in-person workshops as part of this. So the priority areas for these communities of practice are: under energy, we focus on grid-scale renewable energy. The specific subtopics for this year is energy storage and power sector transformation. Clean mobility, we focus on electric vehicles, public transportation, etc. Multi-level climate governance, we'll see it in the next slide. And under NDC finance, we are focusing on blended capital and green bonds this time. So around 200 participants representing 16 plus Asian countries are already part of this growing communities of practice. Next slide, please. Okay, so this multi-level climate governance communities of practice, today's presentation is actually organized as part of, it is one of the activities under MLCG COP. So the priority is to address issues and opportunities in effectively integrating multi-level governance for achieving NDCs. The upcoming activities are in the coming months. We are planning to organize few more webinars. So at the end of this survey, at the end of this webinar, we will populate a survey to get a feedback from you on the specific needs. So accordingly, the webinars will be organized. We are also planning to organize in-person workshops, specifically to foster capacity building and to enable peer learning in these topics. Technical assistance is also available for country governments. If anyone is interested, you can reach out to us. We will share more details on that in coming slides. Next, please. Okay, so these are some of the ongoing technical assistances being provided by ALP, HLS partnership. At the national level, we are helping Sri Lanka with the national electric mobility policy. We are coming up with a framework, and in Vietnam for specific emission factor calculation. So these are all ongoing activities. This is not completed, but we are in the process of supporting them. At subnational level, we are helping Sri Lanka and Bhutan cities to adopt climate resilient city action planning. We are helping Bhutan for pre-BRT study, this bus rapid transit systems. So these are some of the examples we have shown. Next slide. So climate help desk, remote expert assistance is available for countries. So this service is available at no cost to developing countries, including government agencies and consultants, and people who are working directly with country governments to plan and implement their NDCs, LETs, and transparency system. So some of the support being provided is listed in addition to the previous slides. Mongolia is ongoing one, so the rest are completed. If any of you have any such request, you can mail to ALP Secretariat ID. We will share the details with you. Next slide, please. So some of the upcoming events of HLS partnership is shown. Under transport communities of practice, we are organizing a webinar on sustainable green fleet on 10th of October. If any of you is interested to join, you can follow the links. Under finance communities of practice, 2 workshops are being planned. One in Asia Pacific Urban Forum on innovative finance instruments in Malaysia, and the second one is on green bonds readiness framework, that is in November, Hanoi. And finally, we are also organizing an energy storage workshop in Bangkok, Thailand. This is under energy communities of practice. We are also planning to organize a big forum in the first quarter of 2020. These are some of the activities to just to give a glimpse of what ALP is doing. So that's all we have for introduction now. I will now hand it over to my colleague, Mr. Keshav, who is on ground at present in Bhutan to carry out this CRCAP exercises. So I'm introducing Keshav. Keshav, you can please take over.
Hello everyone, my name is Keshav Kumar Jha and I'm representing Asia-led partnership which is hosted by ICLEI South Asia. So again, thank you very much to everyone for participating in this webinar on CRCAP. This project is being carried out in Sri Lanka and Bhutan with support from Swiss Federation. So in my presentation, I will give you a quick snippet overview of the project, and then I will talk about the CRCAP methodology, and then I will also briefly tell you what are the key outcomes and the results on ground that we have managed to achieve over the past few weeks and the months. So next slide, please. So this is a quick glimpse, quick snippet view on the project background. So you can see the title of the project, which is Asia-led partner scaling of the lessons from capacity. So capacity is a basically a full-fledged program that we have been carrying out in the that we have recently concluded in India in four cities. We have basically implemented a number of pilot projects across the air quality sector, then solid waste, then number of urban fragile urban systems. So these this project is a flagship project which have been implemented in number of cities in India. And based on the learning from the capacity city, now we are trying to replicate the similar model in the two more additional countries, which is Bhutan and Sri Lanka. So you can see the second point, which is the objective. The objective is to strengthen the capacity of the cities and in identifying the plan and implement the measure for achieving greenhouse reduction and also enhancing the resilience to climate change in an integrated manner. So this is the overall arching goal of the project, where we are basically helping, technically assisting, providing assistance to the both the countries to orient their policies and programs in a way that not just build increase their resilience but also reduces their greenhouse gas emissions. And of course, as part of this project, we are also helping both the countries, cities, involved cities, to prepare their action plan on the climate change, which is we are calling CRCAP, Climate Resilient Development Action Plan. And also, as part of this process, whole process, we are also helping cities to inventorize their greenhouse gas emissions. As you all understand, how important it is for cities and governments to set up a baseline to basically set a target in terms of reduction their emissions and all. So we are helping cities to unfortunately both the cities in both the countries are piloting this time, first time, the greenhouse gas emission inventory using an international protocol, which is GPC, which has been endorsed by the United Nations body as well. And then subsequent to the greenhouse gas emissions, we are also carrying out the vulnerability assessment, where we are looking at the level of exposure, sensitivity, and capacity assessment for all of their fragile urban systems and vulnerable actors. So this is a quite comprehensive process, which we have been carrying out in both the cities, both the country in the past almost 5-6 month period time. Next slide, please. So as you can see, you must have heard, we are focusing on the climate resilience. So the resilience word itself defines the ability to withstand with any future shocks and stresses, natural climate induced event. So the resilience word defines in a way that we just don't come back in an original form after the natural induced event, but we come back more stronger. So that's the whole definition and premise for climate resilience development. So the cities that are climate resilient, they just don't survive in the climate induced natural event, but they also thrive. So that's the whole intent and premise for building the resilience in these cities. So we are focusing, of course, on the both aspect of the topic, which is adaptation, and then also building the mitigation, where we have an immediate result if we, like, for example, if we do certain changes in the infrastructure, energy transmission, distribution, and electrical appliances, we can immediately see some savings in terms of energy reduction and then GHG emissions. While the adaptation has a long-term benefit, when we are identifying the projects and a strategy and action plan, we are looking at the both angle, both aspect of the climate resilience. Next slide. So this is a green climate cities framework. ICLEI has a more than of 20 years of cumulative expertise on building and managing and preparing a climate action plan. We have been working in more than 100 countries over the past two decades. And this is the whole framework on the green climate cities, where we are focusing on low emission, low risk, and livable cities. So this, you can see this whole paradigm, those whole processes is structured into three main phases, which is analyze, act, and accelerate. And each of these phases have their own subset activities, which is aligned with the, of course, it's also flexible and iterative in nature. So if SimCity want to modify and then use it in a way to achieve maximum impact, they can able to do so. So this is the overall framework, overarching framework on which we are working with the, both the countries. Next slide. This is the methodology. So GCC is basically a framework under which we have all of our activities aligned and program activities are associated. And then this is called Climate Resilient Cities is basically methodology. It's a systemic, it's just a step-by-step process on how we get the commitment from the cities, how we do the research assessment, how we set a baseline, then develop an action plan, and then so and so forth in terms of implementation and mobilization of resources and upscaling. So now I will go into the detail of each and every sectors of these phases. And then, of course, if you have any questions, we can take up all those questions towards the end of the session. Next slide. So one thing I want to stress here, this capacity, this climate resilient city methodology that you are seeing right now, it's a one of its kind unique methodology that has been prepared. And it's the first time in the history that a common tool or a framework that have the method have been prepared, which not only look at the mitigation opportunity, but also look at the adaptation benefits. So it's an integrated climate resilience methodology, which is being currently being piloted and used in both the cities in Sri Lanka and Bhutan. So if you look at the phase one, which is analyze, you can see there are three main key activities where we have we get the commitment from the target agency. They sign the agreement copy for their commitment to follow the Mexico City Pact, Urban Adaptation Charter, and then Paris Agreement and NDC and so on and so forth, like sustainable development goals. So the city government, the subnational authority, they announce their commitment toward the climate resilience. So that is in the form of mayor announcement. And subsequent to that, we also formed the climate core team, which include the commissioners, mayors, and key engineers, and also including the other line departments. And then subsequently, if you look at, we also have a stakeholder group, which include the other line department agencies, and also like-minded institution, civil society groups, and NGOs, and everybody is a part of their stakeholders. So they have a direct say into the planning and overall implementation of the project. And then in the part two of the phase one, we do the research and assessment, where we do the city profile preparation. We also do the climate change impact and resource responses assessment, where we look at the past 30 years of trend of rainfall and temperature from the meteorological department. And we try to assess which are the probable and potential climate risk for those cities and subnational entities, which will further impact and worsen the situation, the existing fragile urban system. So that kind of technical assessment we also do with help of meteorological department, and we then do the climate readiness review. So these are some climate scenario assessment, and everything is being also been carried out in both of these cities, in Bhutan and Sri Lanka. And then most of the very important task, like I said in the beginning, we also help cities to set up their baseline in terms of emission, greenhouse gas emissions. So we have prepared their emission inventory following the international protocol of IPCC and GPC, and they identify their all the sources and sinks for emissions. And then they also identify their fragile urban system, climate vulnerabilities and risk, following a step-by-step systemic process within this framework of climate resilient city. And then we do a baseline synthesis report assessment, which is a part of a chapter in the whole climate action plan of those cities. Next slide. So these are the key critical output of the phase one, where we have the identified climate fragility statement, the specific location and people impacted are identified. So what we do, we identify the, like for example, if there's a city which has a 50 or 60 administrative wards, the zones. So we identify with respect to each and every fragile urban system for solid waste, for sewage and water, which are those areas are vulnerable, and with respect to the systemic issues and challenges. And also when we overlay the impact of climate change, how those systems will respond. So we make those statements, those are called fragility statements and climate fragility statements. And then we assess them on the basis of their impact and exposure and sensitivity. And then, like I said, we also have this carbon intensity report. Summary has been compiled as part of this phase one output. And then for all these critical sectors, for a mitigation and adaptation perspectives are being identified. So this is a quick outcome for the phase one of analyze for the climate this resilient city framework. Next slide, methodology. This is a phase two where we basically identify the resilient interventions. We screen and prioritize them based on their resilient. So there are a set of resilience indicators as a part of this process. We screen and prioritize those interventions based on their resilience capability potential. And then we set up a target. We set a target for emissions reduction and also risk abatement, climate risk abatement, and building of a adaptive capacity. And then the municipal authority and the stakeholders core team approve their, ratify their climate action plan. Which also include the, of course, the project's detail in terms of financial and implementation detail, the financing models and process for securing financing from all types of for donor agencies are also being detailed out in these actions plan. And then, of course, we also include as part of the Bali action plan, we include also the monitoring and reporting and verifications mechanisms which cities can use for their internal or third party verification of their interventions, how well they are progressing in terms of implementation of those priority interventions. So these kind of basic structure and guidelines are being also being provided in these actions plan. Next slide. So you can see these are the critical outputs for phase two, where we prepare and get the ratification from the municipal authority and the national government of the climate action plan, which include, of course, the targets, because without the target, we don't believe there is any relevance for climate action plan. So this include very specific tangible target. And then also information flow to the stakeholder. We disseminate the outcomes of the action plan, which will get disseminated among all the parties, including the national government, and then the private players and the donors, philanthropy and financiers, and whoever is interested to take up their specific project based on their mandate, based on their interest, they can welcome to engage directly with the city government. And then, of course, we also try to demonstrate some projects. Mainly, those are the small-scale projects in terms of the pilot interventions. Like we have done in the capacity project, we have implemented a number of low-hanging quick win projects, which has huge benefit in terms of reducing your energy load and then emissions reductions. And then also this action plan include the overall guiding steps on how we can go ahead for the implementation of the large scale program and project and how it will be the monitored. Next slide. So this is the last phase of the whole methodology, which is acceleration, where we integrate and collaborate to improve the impact of the climate action plan. We also ensure we promote the action plan at the international forum like COP20 and the Asia Pacific Urban Forum and all these platforms, so they get the visibility and recognition of their efforts. And of course, like I said in the beginning, the whole action plan is it's not casted in stone. It's open for review, open for iteration and review. So always, if there is a new government, if there is a new priority or a new strategic development interest, so that can also be incorporated even after 1 or 2 or 3 years of or down the line of the preparation of the action plan. So there is a scope of openness is there. And then, of course, we try to report the progress, the development that city has carried out in terms of implementation of those priority interventions, and then in a way that they also inspire their regional cities and satellite cities of their region to take a similar actions of climate action, because as we know, this is a global problem and we all need to take actions, especially the cities, and cities can be take a major player, crucial role in terms of global actions. So we have these cities as a lighthouse in the region, so they inspire and advocate the change at the local level, and we try to document their progress and achievement, and which we promote it through webinar, through international training program and everything. Next slide. So again, like I said, this is the quick outputs for the phase three. We have increased ambitions, and the outcomes are reported locally, regionally, and globally, and we advocate for the local climate actions. Next slide. So just to give you a quick snippet idea on which cities we are talking about. So in Sri Lanka, we are talking about Kurunegala, which is in the western province in the north of the country. It's in the Sri Lanka is a Kurunegala city, and which has a population of 40,000 people. Its area is 11 square kilometer. And what they have identified, the one of the critical climate risks for them is a rising average mean temperature. And also another second climate risk that they have identified is the high intensity rainfall, especially in the first inter and northeast monsoon seasons. So these are the two climate risks that they have identified and on which they are analyzing the impact of these risks on all of their urban systems. And if you talk about the urban system, which are the urban systems that have been identified as a fragile? So then these are namely six ones. Urban planning is the number one. Then sewerage, stormwater drainage, solid waste, and transport, and education and training. So all of these systems are being categorically identified as a fragile urban system through a number of series of dialogues with the different departments and series of workshops that we had in the Kurunegala over the past 1 year. And if you look at the greenhouse gas emissions, so total emissions is around 91,000 tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. This is, we have not mentioned the base year, but the base year is 2017. 2017 is a year for the emission inventory, and the per capita emissions comes about 2.35 tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. So we have a greenhouse gas emission inventory done and prepared for Kurunegala, and so the baseline is set, and we have also done the vulnerability assessment. So right now we are in the phase of, with help of local government and the national government, we have an active involvement of Ministry of Environment at the government of Sri Lanka. So they're also contributing into the exercise, and we are currently in the phase of almost near the completion of the climate action plan. So then in a week or two, we will have a release, and then the final document will be released during the Sri Lanka Next, which is a national event, Blue Green Sustainability, which will be launched by the Honorable President of the country. So this is happening on 23rd of October, and by that time we'll have the final publication of the action plan for Kurunegala on climate change. Subsequently, we have Bhutan. Bhutan, as per the direction and suggestion from the Happiness Commission, we have taken up Serpang and Gelefu. They are the two. They are the Serpang is a district and Gelefu is a capital city of that district. They're at the foothills of Himalayas at the down at the southern district, close to Assam. And they have a population of 46,000 area. You can see almost 1600 square kilometer. And again, they have also identified the one critical climate risk, which is high intensity rainfall, which result in frequent flooding and landslide across the district. So I'm right now in Gelefu and Serpang, and over the past 4-5 days, I've witnessed myself the impact of the disaster, the impact, the kind of impact these high intensity rainfall has on their infrastructure, on their roads network, which lead to, which increases their risk and impact. And then again, if we had a series of discussion with the administration and the stakeholders, and again, we have also again identified these six critical urban systems on which we are going into the detailed assessment on how these urban systems will react, will respond in terms of climate risk. And we are doing the detailed mapping for vulnerable actors, vulnerable areas, and also doing the level of exposure, sensitivity, and adaptive capacity assessment for all of these urban systems, and also their associated actors. When I say actors, those mean the agencies which are responsible for the management of these urban systems. So that is being, and then in terms of greenhouse gas emissions inventory for the for Serpang and Gelefu, it is currently being carried out. We'll have the result in a week or two. So we'll definitely share with you the outcomes of the inventory and the action plan in the subsequent weeks. Next slide. So you can see these are a couple of pictures for the different impacts and then the infrastructure that they have. Surprisingly for Serpang, it was quite surprising that whatever the waste that they collect, it's a mixed waste. They could directly collect it from the household and they dump it onto the open land. There is absolutely no treatment, no processing of any type of waste. So there's a huge scope because as we all understand, there's a significant amount of methane emission from the open dumping. So that's why we have identified solid waste as one of the critical fragile urban systems, and including the drainage. And we are currently working on, the team is working on assessing, doing the vulnerability assessment and emission inventory and preparation of a climate action plan. Next slide. So this is a Kurunegala. Still a draft, but I still want to share with you some of the actions, the priority action that have emerged from our discussion with the key stakeholders. So you can see the installation of solar rooftop, and then energy efficient street lighting, and then energy efficient buildings, electric mobility, replacement of the fleet from the electric, like you have seen in the first presentation which Anand has talked about. We are also working with the Ministry of Transport in Sri Lanka for preparation of their framework on electric mobility. So they want to procure the buses also for the electric mobility promotion, and then also biomethanation plant setup, and then aerobic treatment technology based sea waste treatment system. So these are some of the actions and priority intervention that have emerged on our discussions with the Kurunegala city stakeholders. And you can see the size, the scale, and the impact in terms of energy saving, and then their fuel production potential, then GHG emission reduction. And also we have identified whatever the interventions were possible to quantify in terms of the costing that we have also mentioned, and the possible implementation modes are also mentioned here. So this is a quick snapshot of the interventions that we have identified for Kurunegala, but this is not any, in any way, this is not exhaustive. This is still indicative because we are still being carrying out assessment. We are identifying the more interventions. So, but like I said, in a week or two, we will have the final action plan. There you can see the whole long list of interventions for the of all types, which has a quick implementation opportunity and which are also the large scale and long term perspective. Next slide. So this is a slide on the resources and the tools that we have. Like I said, we have a framework, overall framework called Green Climate Cities, and then we have a number of tools and resources available with us to help cities to quantify and report their baseline emissions and do the global reporting. We are also actively promoting this global covenant of mayors for climate and energy, which is a regional, which is a global network of cities where cities report their performance, their commitment and actions, and they get the recognition and visibility and support in terms of technical and financial resources to implement their priority interventions. So there are a number of resources and guidance and solutions are available on the global platform through help of ICLEI and its partners and Asia-led partnership. So all of these, both the cities in the Bhutan and Sri Lanka have direct access to these opportunities. So and they are, some of them are also utilizing to mobilize the requisite funding and technical support from the different sources. Next slide. So thank you very much. If there's any question, we can take up now, or if we want, we can take up at the end of the session also. Why I'm saying, because we have also a representative from the Serpong District Administration, the Senior Planning Officer. And so I think we will take the question at the end of the session. Now let me invite his name is Mr. Sering Dendup. And he is a senior planning officer of Serpong District Administration, Royal Government of Bhutan. So what he will do, he will briefly talk about the profile of the district and what are their issues and priorities, and then what is they are up to. So I invite, I request Mr. Sering to speak and present his talk. Thank you very much. Can we have a presentation of Mr. Sering?
Yes. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody online here. Meanwhile, I would like to thank Kesha for a good introduction of me. Well, since my boss, we should call as district administrator, in local term, he's called as Zongda. He is not here, so I represent him as well as the district administration. But then I'm afraid that I may not be able to convince because my English is bad. Plus, I have not been to I have no experiences of having presented in such a big international arena or the other higher level talks. If ever I have made a presentation, I have met with the local leaders, which isn't local dialect. So that's why I'm afraid, I mean to say. So can we go to next slides? Well, this is an administrative map of Serpong District, and it's not so big as you can make out from here. We have an area of 1,655 square kilometers and 10,369 houses spread across 12 sub-blocks, 12 blocks and 172 villages. And we have a population of about 46,000. And I must say that we are a biodiversity hotspot because we have 88% of the area under forest cover. Next slide. The vision of this district is to make it a very dynamic commercial hub with a sustainable rural economy and green environment with undying culture and tradition. In the sense that our development philosophies are guided by gross national happiness, wherein culture and traditional environments are given a top priority. Yes. Next slide, please. And mission. We have four missions here. First is to ensure a sustainable rural livelihood of the people with access to all basic amenities and prompt service deliveries. Second is to ensure balanced socioeconomic advancement with sustainable green environment, and third is to focus. We focus on developing Zhonghua District into a commercial hub. Sorry for the jargon. The fourth is to preserve and promote cultural heritages and strengthen social harmony. Next slide, please. We have several mandates, but I would like to point out here the most important ones, and we are responsible for the implemented social, economic, development policies, plans, and programs of the district. We also execute national policies, plans, programs as directed by the government of the day. We are also responsible for human resource development plan of the Zonka, but then unfortunately we have not been able to do so because of the resource constraints. We are mandated to provide technical best wing to the block administrations, and we are also responsible for personal administration of all civil servants of the district administrations. Next slide. This is the very objective of 12 five-year plans. We started in July 2018, and we are into second financial year. As you know that our development guiding philosophy of development plans of gross national happiness, and that guides whatever objectives we set, whatever we plan for development activities. And the very objective is, you can see here, is just, harmonious, and sustainable society through enhanced decentralization. In fact, the as a GNS, as Bhutan is known by gross national happiness, Bhutan government is focused on creating enabling environment of conditions and access to facilities and all the things. Next slide. And right after the promulgation statement of overall objective of the plan, the deliverables or the development outcomes of the ministries are set, and these deliverables are the intended development outcomes which ministry or an agency aspires to achieve at the end of financial five-year plans. The first it is also called national key result areas, the first being macroeconomic stability. And okay, you can see from here that the most thing pertinent to the today's topic is carbon neutral, climate, and disaster resilient development, and disaster resilient development. At the same time, healthy ecosystem services. And the rest of the thing you can just see it from here. Can we go to next slide? And next slide, please. Let's skip this. Next slide. Until we reach to the picture. Yeah, this is the one. And just under that is the, we call it local government key result areas. And it is also, leaving other key result areas behind. Let me point out, the ninth key result areas here. Carbon neutral, climate, and disaster resilient development enhanced here. And in a sense that, our local government result areas must contribute to national key result areas that are, aligned and linked to nine domains of gross national happiness. At the same time, it is also integrated or aligned to sustainable development goals, except for the, life underwater. And below that, below the, local government key result areas are the programs and activities that will contribute to achievement of key result areas of the local government. That would, again, as I mentioned, contribute to national key result areas and objectives, and at the top, achieving the goal of gross national happiness. Next, please. Next slide. Now, as district administrations, please, previous slide, please. Previous slide, socioeconomics. As district administrations are responsible for, providing basic amenities and fundamental services such as health, education, let me also briefly mention here that we have achieved 99% of mobile service coverage, and we have also, enhanced access to markets like through construction of block connectivity roads, farm roads, and so on. We have also 98% 98% of our households have access to electricity, and 98% of our population have access to health facilities, and that too within the working distance. And our water supply access to at least 99.4% of the population have access to clean, safe, and tap water. And next social indicator is enrollment in the education, in the sense that we have achieved already 100% of enrollment. That means no children under the age of 12 are left in the villages without getting education access. And our literacy rate stands at 72.4%, and thanks to this enrollment and literacy rates were possible because of 11 secondary schools, 11 primary schools, two extended classrooms, 59 non-formal education centers, and of course other also support from the local governments. However, we are sad to mention that we have a of 12.1%, but then the going by the multi-dimensional poverty rate, we would be we are much better, I would say, because our multi-dimensional poverty rate stands at 0.027 only. Sadly, our 2.3% of our population are under unemployed as per the population and housing census between 2007. Can we go to the next slide, please? Despite the fact that we have made a tremendous success, we are a good success. We the Serpong district, by virtue of having located at the foothills, is vulnerable to flooding because we have a long monsoon season of around 5 to 6 months. That makes the gullies and small streams of soil in the monsoon season. And as per my record, close to 200 acres of land have been lost over the last 5 years, and around 90 acres of land have been lost by very bad flooding in 2016, along with 63 houses impacted and 2,000 people badly affected. But then there needs to be still the vulnerability is high because we have around we have around 10 streams and several gullies where we need to provide protection, flood protection walls. We are the Bhutan is a resource constant, and we are financially disadvantaged. And here too, it is also compounded, the flooding problem is compounded again by lack of capacity, in the sense that our staff have very low exposure, plus they don't have much training. We have a very limited holders and master's holders. That means they have no capacity to design whatever design and plan whatever we would like to bring out mitigation measures. And fallow land is another problem we have because it is also attributed to insufficient water. When I say the insufficient water, you must be feeling what kind of the fallow lands are one of the reasons that the people leave the land with insufficient water and wildlife threats. But then the problem of insufficient water will be addressed very soon because we have proposed for other areas. The next problem is we have from the health in the health sector, we have zoonotic diseases happening, malaria, dengue, and next thing is solid waste, stormwater drainage system. And for mitigation as well as adaptation, we are planning we are preparing a climate resilient action plan with support from, you know, GNS Commission and EPLIA, Asia Leads organizations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sering, for your excellent presentation on the profile and what are your issues and challenges and priorities. We are extremely honorable and glad to have an association, your partnership to develop on this project, to develop a climate resilient action plan. So thank you very much for your participation. So what I will do now, we have two various specific questions from the participants. I will take up, I will take these questions one by one, and then still, if you have any question, we can take up now, otherwise we can close the session. So the first question that the participant have, the Mr. Rajeshwar has asked, how to enforce the regulation in cities of developing countries? So what our experience is that, especially in terms of the South Asian countries, we have to basically incentivize in a way that it becomes smooth for the government officials to enforce the regulation. Because as we all know that we have number of policies, regulations and laws, but they have not been dovetailed at the ground level. They have not been enforced or implemented. So in a way, what we have seen and what we have also practiced through our project, for instance, giving the rebate in terms of property tax collection and then property tax rate. So that could be one incentive mechanism to ensure that people take resilient intervention or energy efficient interventions or building codes implementation for while they construct a new building or retrofitting measures. So this is one example. There are hundreds of more, thousands of more examples for across the sectors. Yes, there are many number of ways that can be incorporated and designed or implemented to enforce the policies and regulations in these cities. So that's number one. I hope it answers your questions. But still, if you have clarifications or questions, you can feel free to write us an email and we'll get back to you with a detailed response. The next question is, are there any specific intervention customized for the benefit of women and children in the action plan? Yes, definitely. Women and children are being exclusively looked after, and they have been identified as one of the critical vulnerable actors in the both the cities' vulnerability assessment profiling. And they have been their participation have been ensured not just the in the project results, but also their participation ensured in the planning itself. We have various women local representatives from different organizations and different civil society based organizations. So they have participated in the shared learning dialogues and then focus group discussions. And they are part of the design, they are part of the committees and core team, and they are contributing effectively what is their policies, what are their solutions, what are their priorities, and we are incorporating into this action plan. For example, I want to give you a special case of Bhutan. Bhutan has a policy itself. There is a national government policy that 30% participation need to be ensured in all level of planning. Whichever sector planning you do, you have to ensure 30% of female participation across the sector, across the level. So yes, similar with the same vision, with the same intent, we have also incorporated into the climate action plan. We have a committees led by the women representatives and stakeholder committees. And then also, like I said, when we do the shared learning dialogues, we do the focus group meetings. So we ensure the active participation of women and children also, the representatives, and then school people, the eco-school, eco-campus, and then also the actions, the intervention, the proposal that are being prioritized in the action plan that should also target and help these vulnerable communities, sections of the society. So yes, they have been taken care of and they're extremely part of the process and for which we are extremely proud. So I hope this answers your question.
Thank you very much.
Yes, I pass on to Mr. Anand.
Thank you. Sure. If anyone else has questions, kindly raise your hands. You can see the options in GoToWebinar and we will unmute you. Also, in the meantime, I have a question to Mr. Sharing. So how do you see the CRCAP process? Because a lot of stakeholder meetings are being conducted to do this vulnerability assessment to identify the vulnerable spots under urban planning and many other sectors. So how do you see this processes? What you can share your experiences in carrying out these exercises?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the question. And that in the sense that you want us to, you know how beneficial will it be, right? Yes. Yeah, right. That's the right question, I think. Yeah. Since we have the since we don't have the capacity to carry out this this kind of action planning, you know, or exercise, that the Asia leads in collaboration with the GNSC Commission, Bhutan has come up here, and they are taking up the exercise. So, in a sense that we are happy that, you know, because we lack capacity, we have not been able to do so far. And that when the expertise comes here, it's we feel proud to have them, and we are really thankful to them. Thank you, sir.
Sure, we have a question from Rajesh. I am just unmuting you.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes,
we can. Yes, this is more a kind of sharing of our practical constraints, particularly urban climate resilience in developing countries. And it's one thing about land use planning, whether it is lung spaces in terms of urban green cover, are urban sponges, that is water bodies that absorb the flash flooding shocks of what is untimely rains and heavy disturbed rainfall pattern of climate change. And the second point is in situ slum development, squatters and settlers, and there's a kind of poles apart. Geographically they are same, but they're living in different worlds. How to involve, of course, capacity building and orientation awareness is one thing. In planning itself, how to make it mandatory to make cities entitled and eligible for attracting incentives. In-situ slum development is one component, social component of climate resilient urban planning for this city. Thank you.
Sure, thank you very much, Rajeshwar, for your insights. So since we have come to the scheduled end of the session, we will close now. If you have further questions, we encourage you to mail it to us. And finally, we have just have to say, in continuation to the exercises we are carrying out in Sri Lanka and Bhutan. So on 7th and 8th of this month, an exposure training workshop is being conducted for Kurnegala city. And for this workshop, the people from Bhutan and also the satellite cities of Kurnegala are visiting. So this will be a very good exposure visit for them. And all these activities are carried out as part of this multi-level climate community practice. And if you want to know more about our activities, you can follow us on website or social media.
Sure,
and we encourage you to join our communities of practice. And we hope to stay in touch with you. We will share more details about upcoming events, etc. As we
thank
go.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you,
everyone, for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone, for your participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.